Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Angela Rolla. I'm the director of the Asian American Cultural Center. If none of you have ever visited the center, we certainly invite you to come visit us on the fourth floor of the Student Union. The center is open. There's not a membership. There's no secret password. There's no fee. So please come over. We're open until 9 o'clock in the evenings. Our programs are open to you, and it's just a nice space to come and study, bring your lunch, hang out with people, just find a really quiet place on campus. Sometimes, not all the time, is it quiet. Today's program that we have is part of our SLAM book club, and SLAM stands for Sampling Literature by Asian Americans. It's been going on for many, many years, in which we select authors. It started out as a fiction and nonfiction book club, but now it's only for fiction that we concentrate on, and it really focuses on stories about Asian Americans and the different ethnic groups that we have in our very diverse community, and growing up Asian American and coming into our identity as Asian Americans. So this year we have chosen the book Chemistry, and I was very excited about it when I heard a review on NPR in the summer, and I've asked students who work for us in the Cultural Center to take a read and see how they reacted to it, and they certainly said this is somebody that we would like to bring to campus and have a discussion about the book. So with that, I hope that you enjoy today and that you come back for more. We do have an event on October 25th. It's a documentary by a documentary filmmaker, Prakash Wadhwa, from the Midwest. And his documentary is entitled From the Land of Gandhi, in which he will be talking about the high-skilled laborers, high-skilled workers that we bring from India, and how they get caught in American work because they've been sponsored by American corporations, but for them to get their green cards and for them to move on to other jobs and move around the country sometimes is very difficult. So if you're interested in that, that will be at 6 o'clock on the 25th over in Conover Auditorium at the Dodd Center. So you don't have to remember all of those, just go to our website and you can see a list of all of our events. So with that, I'd like to introduce one of the programmers at the Cultural Center, Holly Zhang, who will be introducing our author for tonight. Thank you very much for coming. Holly?
So as Angela said, I am Holly, and Holly Zen, and I am one of the programmers for the Asian American Cultural Center. And today I have the pleasure to introduce Waiki Wang, the author of Chemistry. And just a brief synopsis on her: she graduated from Harvard with an undergrad in chemistry, and she has received a Master of Science degree as well as a Doctor of Science degree from the Harvard Chan School of Public Health, as well as her Master's of Fine Arts in Fiction from Boston University. Currently, she is working as a senior consultant of the China Educational Development and Consulting Associates. With that, would you help me welcome our author, Waiki Wang?
Thank you for having me. A little bit of a cold, so if I don't sound perfect, I'm very sorry. I listen to my bio all the time, and sometimes I feel like I should just get rid of all the degrees because it takes up so much time to read, and then I get very embarrassed, and then it provokes a lot of questions. So it should just be maybe Waiki Wang, New York writer. I lived in Boston for a really long time, and now I live in New York, which is very cliche. I'm a writer in New York. I don't think any of those exist. But I want to start by reading a little bit from my book and then discussing some background about this book, how I came to write it, my background, and generally my experiences as a student, where I come from, and what writing this book has meant to me in interacting with different readers when I have been on tour. Also, I'm open to any questions from aspiring young writers or just, you know, questions about the book. I don't want it to be sort of like a PowerPoint presentation where I go through all the bullets, but feel free to interrupt me if you have any questions. So I'm reading from near the beginning of the book. I used to just read the beginning, but then I got a little bit bored of that. So I'm gonna read a little bit into the book. There's nothing that you really need to know about this section other than the fact that she has she's been kicked out of her doctoral program, and she's probably not the most mentally stable person at this time. Her boyfriend's name is Eric, and at the very beginning of the book, he asks her to marry her, and she hasn't given him an answer, and that's sort of the driving question throughout this book, but also, you know, what she wants out of life. So we'll start reading. I lose track of the days. Is it the weekend, or is it microwavable spring rolls day? Every meal we eat off of paper plates on our laps. No more dishes, I decide, too much work. End of fall weather. There is an advisory out for hailstorms. I am out when it starts and little flecks of white stab my eyes. The hail comes down hard and fast and pelts everything. Then what follows is a freakish rainstorm where standing outside for a millisecond feels like being hit with a high-powered hose. There is an advisory out for high winds. Gusts of more than 40 miles an hour are expected. We close all of our windows and climb into bed, but we can still hear the sound of branches breaking and falling and trash cans lifting off. This stupid city, I say the next morning when I'm out walking through the streets looking for our trash can. Eric has something to tell me. He brings me to the couch to do it. Are you listening, he says. Listening. Perhaps you should go see the shrink. What shrink? I tossed out the contact information immediately. I had not even entertained the thought of going. Do you think something is wrong, I ask? Because nothing is wrong. I'm entirely happy. My laugh that follows, it is very manic sounding. With my father, I do not like asking questions. He's not tall, but at 10, I must crane my neck to see him. For every question I ask, why does ice float on water? Why are negative numbers not prime? He says, you have a brain and two hands. You can look up that answer yourself. Then a question he poses to me, did anyone teach him advanced math or did he learn it himself? Yet ironically, he teaches me, and the kind of teacher he is. Once he says something the first time, he will not say it again. You have a brain and two hands. Look up the answers yourself. You want to know how to get through life? Pay attention. A habit that forms from this is that I can only ask Eric questions when he is asleep. Once I hear the first snore, I say, why is your trajectory so straight? Why is your family so nice? It seems unfair how easy everything comes to you. In your last life, you must have been a dung beetle, or somebody who gave up his life for someone else, perhaps a pregnant woman crossing the street. Do you remember? Then I part his red hair and bring my voice down to a whisper. Please stop just for a little while and let me catch up. How do you expect me to marry you if you never let me catch up? I am braver now. I can say these things when he's awake. Go talk to her, he says, this time very firm, very serious. I mean it, he says, this time very quiet. In those initial sessions, I arrive at her office in big sunglasses and a long puffy coat. Halfway through the hour, she says, feel free to take off those sunglasses anytime. And I make up some excuse of why I can't. My pupils were recently dilated. These are the only prescription glasses I have. I sit as close to the door as possible. I never take off that coat. Also, it is the start of winter and I am professionally cold. Once home, I tell Eric that I had seen her. Was he happy? To the woman in charge of my health insurance, I ask, and you're sure that my parents will not find out about the shrink? Not unless you decide to do something drastic, she says. Like this, a dream I recently had where I was swimming in an Olympic-sized pool of dichloromethane, a solvent that burns when rubbed on skin. I swam and swam and drowned. The woman says, yeah, like that. I find it funny just the thought of what my mother would say if she knew I was going to see a shrink, talk to a stranger about your problems, pay a stranger to listen. The first time Eric says, "I love you," it is in lab, before meeting. He thinks he will wait until after my meeting, but he has been anxious all day. He hasn't slept. He catches me before I walk into the conference room and just says it. I freeze. I feel my skin burn to a crisp. Do I go to this meeting? I do, but remember nothing. What the shrink says from day one, the chasm you need to cross is not a physical one. Then what is it, I ask. I much prefer the physical one. Tell me to walk across the Grand Canyon on a tightrope, balancing an apple on my head, and I'll do it. A year into our dating, Eric says he wants to understand me, and not just from a distance, or through what he calls my 10-inch thick bulletproof glass. Behind this glass, he says he has found more glass. An involuntary tic I have is that I cannot hold hands for a long period of time. My thumb eventually digs into the center of his palm and makes him let go. Hold my hand like a normal person, he yells. I'm sorry, I yell back. He is baffled that we are still having this problem. We're out with a dog. We are getting takeout. I meander back and forth. He then grabs my hand again. I focus with all my might to not move the thumb. Here's a joke a classmate tells me in middle school. When an Asian baby is born, her parents hold up two signs, doctor or doctor, and the baby must choose. By now, I've heard many versions of this joke. Times change, so no longer doctor or doctor, but doctor or scientist, doctor or engineer, doctor or investment banker. It isn't so much of a joke as a statement. Where did you hear that, I ask her, and she says her parents. Then I watch her bend over with laughter. When she bends back, I want to kick her. She asks if my parents ever held up signs. I say no. She says they must have. I say no. Then she goes to the teacher and calls me a liar. This classmate and I never became friends. I wish I'd kicked her. When I say this to the shrink, she says, stand in front of a mirror. Your reflection is a way to deal with episodes of anger. But I'm not angry, I say. Oh, yes, you are. Thank you. So that's the section from the middle part of the book. Not the middle, closer to the beginning. I want to talk a little bit about my background and this background for this book. I didn't always want to be a writer. I think that's not something you grow up wanting to be. You grow up wanting to be, an astronaut. You grow up wanting to be rich. I don't think you ever want to grow up being a writer. I heard another writer say that to be a writer, you really have to take the oath of poverty, which sounds a little bit sad when you're younger. But when I was younger, I didn't know what I wanted to be. I was born in China, and I was there for about 5 years. So I learned Chinese there. That was my first language. And then after that, I had moved to Australia. I did my primary education there. So I learned English there. I went to elementary school there. And I left there when I was 11. So I sort of spent a lot of my childhood there. Australia is sort of what you expect as a country. I don't think I ever wore shoes for the 6 years I was there. You just go to school barefoot, and then you're in class barefoot. So I lived, when I was in Australia, I lived in Brisbane, which is very close to the Great Barrier Reef, so it's in Queensland, while my dad was doing his doctorate. And then after that, I moved to Canada, so we just kept moving. So I moved to London, which is a city outside of Toronto. Have people here been to Toronto? Know what Toronto is like? Yeah, it's very, it's just two Chinatowns, which kind of confused me. So I enjoyed London. I enjoyed being in Canada. It's very cold. There I learned, right, the Australian accent sounds very weird. To change your accent to fit in. That's why I don't sound like I'm from Australia. And then when I was about 13, so I had spent 2 years in Canada, I moved to Massachusetts. So my dad was going from job to job, and I was in Massachusetts for a little bit. I was there for 2 years, and then I moved to Michigan, which is where I went to high school. So I went to high school outside of Detroit. It's more in the suburbs of Detroit. The suburbs of Detroit are much nicer than, you know, that movie 8 Mile that portrays Detroit as very rugged, and everybody raps in Detroit, actually. And that's sort of where I went to high school. I had a really great experience in high school. I went to a high school that didn't have any sports, so that's actually very rare in America, I think. So there's no football, there's no, I guess football is the only sport that really resounds in high school. And it was a very academic school, so it was a math and science school. It was very small, so we had, my class was maybe 100 people. It was a very nurturing environment. And then I've been there for, after high school, I moved back to Boston, and that's where I went to college, and that's where I stayed for the last 10 years before moving to New York. So I've done a lot of moving, which makes the question, you know, where I'm from, where my parents are from, very hard to answer. It's also probably one of those stories that I'll eventually write into a novel, but I'm probably not going to write about it just yet because it's such a, you know, it's an intercontinental immigrant story. So, it, you know, taking place in a lot of different lands, and that's a little bit hard to manage right now. But when I had left high school, I was feeling that because I'd gone to such a rigorous school in math and science, I expected of myself that I would become maybe a scientist, an engineer, something in the very in the STEM field. I was very good at it. And one thing that this book tries to address, and this protagonist tries to address, which is also my internal conflict as well, is do you like something because you're good at it, or are you good at something and therefore you like it? I think that's a hard question to answer. I'm sure a lot of people here have experienced the praise that comes from being good at something, and that makes you like it even more, versus liking something and maybe not being very good at it, right? So this narrator is trying to parse that out. Whether that can be parsed out or not is also a good question. Sometimes those two things coexist. And that's something that I've been struggling with for also a very long time, is dealing with this idea of what feel, you know, after a certain point you have to pick, right? In high school, it's encouraged that everybody is very well-rounded, right? Think about when you guys were applying to college, the idea that you have to be good at a lot of things, you know, be the athlete, be a good student, right? Have extracurriculars. That's pretty demanding of your time. And as an adult, you don't do any of that, right? I don't do any extracurriculars, right? I write, maybe occasionally I go to the gym, but that's it. I think about my high school life, and it was nuts. I was in, you know, 10 different clubs, and I was also a varsity swimmer, so it was kind of multiple demands of my time. So when I went to college, the sense that you had to pick a major, right? That in and of itself is a little bit challenging. You know, what do you pick? There's so many subjects out there, and it's something that I still struggle with. So I had picked chemistry as my major because I was naturally very good at it, and I liked chemistry. And when I was in high school, I'd been part of the National Chemistry Olympiad team and also the Science Olympiad team. So you sort of get my trajectory here at this point. So I went into Harvard thinking that I would be a chemist or be a doctor or some of these things. And the line in the book with the signs, it's not, you know, science obviously never held up signs, but how would I remember, right? I would have been 1 year old. And at Harvard, when I was, what happens in college, I think what happens to a lot of students, not just American students, is that you really get to see a larger population of people. So for me, when I was figuring out my major, I was seeing a lot of people who were very good at chemistry or very good at science or very good at writing. And that, at the time, can be discouraging. And one aspect that this book tries to go through is that this chemist, she's good at what she does, but she's not the best. And I think she has an issue with figuring out, you know, how to reconcile that with herself. You know, she sees so many very successful women in her field, successful men in her field, and that somehow discourages her. It's not the community that she had originally hoped. So in her kind of graduate school turmoil, as I took a leaf out of my own, obviously, undergrad experience of what it was like to go to a very high caliber school, a very intense school, and what that can maybe do to your kind of mental energy. So when I was, I chose to do chemistry, and then I chose as a minor to do English. So I was doing creative writing as maybe a hobby, stress relief. It was fun. The English department is also very nice and warm as comparison to maybe a chemistry department. And as an undergrad, I worked in a lab, and I drew heavily from that experience to write this book. I'd never gone to chemistry grad school, nor would I go to chemistry grad school, but I was in a very intense graduate level lab, and I got to see what that did to some of the students, and what that did to some of the relationships between advisor and student. And I felt that I needed to write about that. I mean, I didn't know it then, but I think I was prepared to write that later on. But that was sort of stuck in my, that experience stayed with me. So after college, I took a year off, and I was thinking of applying to medical school. So I went through all of that. I think there was a year I took every single standardized test out there, minus the LSAT, because I knew I wasn't going to go to law school. And then I applied to medical school. I went on the interview circuit. I met doctors, physicians. I worked for a cardiologist. And at that time, I wasn't really sure if that was what I wanted to do. So it's hard, even for somebody that seemed to have a very straight trajectory coming out of high school, I wasn't entirely convinced of what I wanted to do. Somehow I landed in a program for biostatistics. So I like doing research. I knew I liked doing research, and I wanted to explore that a little bit more. And that was a PhD program in like health data analysis and whatnot. So it doesn't get any weirder. When I was doing that program, I thought, why not make my life even busier? I should apply to an MFA program at BU. So during my third year as a grad student, I thought, why not? I don't know if I want to be a writer, but I like writing. I've been writing since I started college, and I've been writing since high school. This program is free. It's right here. I'd only apply to that one program, and I thought, if I don't get in, then it's probably a sign. For somebody who's gone through as much science training as I have, I really do take science seriously for some reason. So I thought it was going to be a sign if I could get in or didn't get in. And miraculously, I actually did get in. It's a program of 10 people for a year at BU, and you workshop stories, you write stories, and as a thesis, you can write a novella. So this was my thesis for my MFA program. I had, in a course of, I think, 6 months, really tried my best to produce the best work that I could, because it was the last time that my advisor would ever read something that I wrote voluntarily. And that was my MFA thesis. And the story unfolded from there, that it was then my advisor liked it a lot. It was received well. And I was then put in touch with Random House. So sort of a fairy tale story in terms of how this book actually got published, but pretty painful in the whole writing process of it. And in the revision process, I would say total, it still took about 2 years. There's many, many drafts in the story. So that's a little bit of the background of the story and of how I got to writing about this girl in a grad program who is a little bit lost. I wouldn't say that this is, the question that I constantly do get is how autobiographical is the story? And I would say that 50% maybe, if I had to quantify it, maybe even less. I would say nothing in this book has ever necessarily happened to me, but I've heard of these stories happening to students. I also have many friends in this field. I also have seen sort of relationships combust over this idea of where students are going, where are you going to go to school? It's called the two-body problem, that you have to, you know, find a location for your significant other. So I was in this world of scientists and doctors and very high achieving, you know, Asian American women, men, but also just people trying to find a job, trying to graduate. And one of the reasons I took to writing about this character is that I felt the story of the grad student, especially the science grad student, has not really been told, right? So many books in literature about writers, that makes sense because the people writing them are writers. A lot of books about screenwriters or editors, the world of Hollywood, right? For people in the humanities. And I just felt that science wasn't, or scientists, chemists, they weren't necessarily portrayed in a way that I thought was necessarily realistic. There's a lot of stereotypes that follow maybe chemists or scientists that, and doctors even, that we have it all together, that we know exactly what we're doing, that we're super objective, that we don't take anything personally. I actually find that the longer I've seen in research, the more personal people actually take their research. They actually do see this inanimate thing, this trait of nature as a personal extension of themselves, and they get very, very wrapped up in their work. As much as a book is, or a creative project is sewn essentially into the skin of an artist, the work of a scientist is also sewn into their skin. And it is a highly personal field, and highly, highly subjective, I think. As much as we think scientists are objective and they're calm, they're certainly not calm. And they're very emotional, and there's a lot at stake for them. So I wanted to bring that world to life because I felt that I wanted to really humanize that experience of finding yourself, but also before finding yourself, completely losing yourself. Completely losing yourself and losing faith in yourself. I do think that's the natural trajectory of finding out if you what you want to do, whether this is a good fit, and that's what I wanted to show with this character. So one aspect of writing this book was I wanted to bring, you know, the world of science in and humanize it. That's what writers are always doing. We're trying to humanize experiences. You know, in class, I teach two writing classes in New York, one at Barnard and one downtown with adults. But not that, you know, Barnard students are not adults, but sort of like older individuals. So the stories are, I always tell my students that you have to try to humanize everybody, even the antagonist or even the villain. Not every villain is a bad person. And how many stereotypes follow the scientists as being either mad or completely cold? Neither of those things are true. Just like there are so many stereotypes that maybe follow the Asian American character, right? Not just Asian American, but minority characters. I can speak personally from experience as an Asian American woman, but the idea that, you know, something that this character fights against is, as a student, but also as an individual, there's so much expectation for her to perform. She's considered, she's fighting against a lot of those traits that, you know, she's trying to figure out herself, right? She wonders if everybody thinks that she's very quiet, or she's this perfect put-together person, or this sort of model minority. Isn't that also what we think of scientists, as put-together, as model citizens, right? As very reasonable, logical, not at any point irrational. So she's fighting against kind of those stereotypes that follow her, through her occupation and also through her identity. And I think that's something that's the obstacles that she's trying to go through. As kind of an extension of why I chose to write about an Asian American protagonist, you know, that's a question that I haven't been asked too much, just because I'm Asian American, so it's obvious why I would write about an Asian American protagonist. But not every Asian American writer writes an Asian American protagonist. I think I'm reading Ishiguro's Never Let Me Go, and it's set in a British boarding school. You know, very, and Remains of the Day. It's not with Asian protagonists. It's not, you don't have to write about Asian people if you're Asian. But I think when I first started to write, I was very aware that of race and gender. So for all of my stories, when I first started to workshop stories, was that I didn't have any race. I just gave them. Sometimes I didn't even name the characters, and I don't name that many characters in here either. I didn't name the characters. I didn't give them race. Sometimes I didn't even give them gender, because when I was starting to write, I just wanted it to be about the human experience and how universal the human experience was. And to an extent, that was fairly successful. I also, from an artist's point of view, I didn't want to give the reader the privilege of knowing the background of the characters. I wanted the reader to work a little bit more for the story. So when I first started writing, a lot of my characters were raceless. I just never thought that race was that important to the character's identity. And this has slowly changed through workshop, through my own sort of approach to how I craft stories. I do think race, gender, these are obviously highly important. But I think I wanted to, when I started writing this book, I imagined that, you know, she's an Asian American woman in a field that's mostly men, but I didn't necessarily want that to be a standout feature. You know, I didn't want her to use her gender or her race as an excuse for how she performed or how she didn't perform. I still wanted it to be a human story, and a story that maybe other readers, other students can relate to, that, yeah, she has a cultural background and maybe a history and maybe certain types of parents, but there are also many parents who are like this, and you don't necessarily have to be Asian parents, but parents with expectation and expectations and her own expectations that I wanted to dig through as well. So I think that's why I also chose to do a very close lens of her to figure out how she was feeling. And these are the feelings that I think a lot of people experience, that it's not just because, oh, she's Asian, so she's thinking this way. I don't think that's actually how our brain works. So a little background about why I had, you know, set aside this book, or started writing this book. And just as, you know, a general idea of, as a student, deciding what you want to do, you know, I still get this question that, oh, Wifey, what do you, my friends ask me this question now, Wifey, what are you doing now, because they think I'm unemployed, which is somewhat true. As a writer, you are not employed, really, in the sense that you don't get health benefits or whatnot. And that is still a question that I struggle with, and I'm, you know, 30, so I'm thinking, well, am I going to do this writing thing? You know, how am I going to write for the next 30 years? Or should I be getting a job? Or should I be going back into science because I've done so much training for it? That is something that I don't think the questions necessarily disappear. But you get better at justifying, okay, well, I'm going to do this for a little bit and see where I end up. I think the older you get, the less of a five-year plan there is. And when I was younger, when I was 15, I was like, I had this 20-year plan of what I was going to do. But as I've gotten older, I feel like I have less and less of a plan. It's sort of, well, I'm going to try to write the second book and see how that goes, and look for jobs in this area, and sort of just take it one task at a time. And I think that's actually how you do end up finding yourself. You do it one piece at a time. It's not sort of like a bridge where you start walking and then you end up and you found yourself. You know, it's not really what they love. So that would be nice. For this novel, that one other aspect that I wanted to touch on with how I wanted to write it and what I hoped can be gained from it is that I wanted to do a little bit, I wanted to do something a little bit different for Asian American literature. I think when I started writing this novel and when I first started reading Asian American novel, I was a little bit disappointed in the scope of the literature. I just thought it was a little bit confined, or it was, it lacked a certain kind of humor that I really wanted. I do think not just Asian American literature, but immigrant literature in general can be very somber. And I understand why. There's so much at stake, right? You move this family over, you know, multiple continents, and there's a lot at stake. There's a lot of sorrow, there's a lot of pain. But what I wanted to bring was, I also wanted to just bring a little bit of humor to this experience, right? So people watch that movie National Lampoon, it's the summer vacation. So for me, that's what the immigrant experience was really like. It's this just wreck of, it's this car ride across the country that is somewhat of a disaster, but in the end, you stick together. So I kind of see the immigrant experience that way, that it is very stressful. A lot of bad things can happen. People die, you know, get into car accidents, get into a ton of fights. But in the end, there's something somewhat humorous about how, as people, we got ourselves into this situation, and how if you come out, I guess, on the other side, somewhat how funny it is at times. And that's one aspect that I wanted to bring to this kind of literature. So I guess I wanted to open the floor up to maybe questions, if people had questions about this book that we can discuss. Yeah.
So you talked about a lot of different tracks that you wanted to sort of address through the book.
Yeah.
I think one thing that you haven't talked about at all is mm-hmm. the mental health aspect mm-hmm. of it, and mm-hmm. how much that affected the way you were writing the protagonist's mental health.
Yeah.
How you were portraying it in the book, and did your experiences in grad school? Whether firsthand or secondhand, mm-hmm. affect how you showcase it.
Right. So it's interesting. After this book came out, Psychology Today interviewed me, and then a bunch of other magazines said, we really like how you know your take on depression. And for me, I didn't even think this girl was depressed until somebody told me that she was. So you can sort of imagine what I was thinking about her mental state. And I guess I like that you brought up the idea of mental health and mental health in the grad student world and also I guess in the college world mental health is not necessarily something that is talked about that much. The way that I think I was writing this novel from her point of view very very closely was that I don't even think she realized she was in depression until she was in it. So the way I sort of see her stability is kind of like very similar to a parabola where she really reaches the bottom and then she has to rebuild. That's kind of how I outlined it to my workshop group. And the sort of the slope is what I feel depression is, or some other mental illness, is that you just slowly fall into it, and then before you know it, you're sort of stuck at the very bottom and you don't really know how to get out. My own grad school experience was actually fairly good. I had a tenured professor. So once you have a tenured professor, they do sort of peace out a little bit, and they're very nice. And for those of you who might not be familiar, tenure means that they already have their job. You know, that it's very hard to fire them. So I had a tenure advisor, and that was a very pleasant experience. I still talk to him. Very nice. He's a huge Pats fan. So I learned a lot about Tom Brady during my 5 years with him, because to talk to him about anything, I didn't know a little bit about Tom Brady. And so that was actually a very pleasant experience. The experience that I was drawing on was mostly from my undergrad, that I had been in a lab with junior faculty, and junior faculty tend to be a little bit more intense. They drive the students very hard, and they expect a lot.
Even for undergrads, I was, when I signed up for the lab, I was told by the advisor that I was not going to be treated any differently from the grad students. I was expected to work 8 hours a week, and I was expected to show up on time. And I was working on the day of my graduation, so, you know, Harvard graduation, we're supposed to be at 6 a.m. I was in lab doing, I think I was doing kinetics data on the NMR. So the intensity of my undergrad lab really did inform my grad school experience. And what I was seeing with mental health was that mental health does go unnoticed. It's not that there aren't resources to help you. It's just that a lot of students won't admit that they have, they don't want to be labeled as mentally unstable or mentally ill. They don't want to be labeled as depressed. So even though the resources are there, I feel like some students don't actually make use of it. They would act before confiding in a stranger or maybe a social worker or a therapist about it, they would probably confide in their friends and try to get through it. I mean, that is the mentality of grad school humanities and science. It's just to get through it for 5 years. A lot of English grad students, they're just in the library for 5 years, and they say they don't talk to anybody for 3 of those years. So it is a lonely experience, and it just because the mentality is we're just going to keep our head down and work, that is how it's actually that's how most students actually approach it. Because there's light at the end of the tunnel. After you graduate, you have this degree, and then life will probably get a little bit better. So it is somewhat of a, I guess, bleak landscape. I think the more that, I do think as in certain fields, it is maybe up to the advisor and up to the older grad students to sort of set an example. The lab that I was in, it was almost, shameful, you know, to be anything that would be, you know, considered weak, right? Like working anything less than 80 hours a week would be considered weak. So that needs to change, right? That's not that needs to change for sort of the environment to get a little bit better. Well, does that answer your question? Does anybody else have questions about the book?
Yeah, your mom was a real interesting character.
The mom character.
Did you make her up, or
did she? So I would say that the mom is not my mother. Although my parents have not read the book for obvious reasons. But no, it's the mom is, I would say, like 50% my mom and 50% the mom of a couple of my really close friends to create this character. Is that I think the untold story is that even though immigrants come over and one person fulfills the dream, another person completely gives up the dream, right? So it's an averaging effect. And the person who gives up the dream, it's not really written about how they feel about sort of standing by someone. And you know, I was having a conversation with this about with some of my friends. The mother figure, I wanted to keep her fairly general, but more, you know, she's Asian, so there's her Asian heritage. But I also just wanted her to be this immigrant who comes to this new country, at the age of 32, 33, has to learn a new language, and just completely fails, right, at that, and is not adjusted for this place. And that happens. Sometimes we're not as adaptable as we think we are. And as a result, you know, this kind of person gets angry at herself. I also wanted to try to portray maybe the imperfect mother. I think mothers are sometimes too hard on themselves and each other. And I just felt that there are a lot of different kinds of mothers out there. The contrast in this book is between maybe Eric's perfect mother, I wouldn't even say Eric's mother is perfect, it's just from the narrator's point of view, this mother is perfect, right? This mother says, I love you all the time. Whether that's a way of habit, or whether she's actually sincere about it, you know, this mother visits, or this mother writes notes, and it's just something that the narrator's mother never does. So she's trying to grapple with differences in how she was brought up, is her mother a good mother or is she not a good mother? Why is she so loyal to her mother? Sometimes that question is actually really hard to answer. She's your mom, so you're really gonna stand by her no matter what. And she, you know, the mom has been through a lot, so how do you weigh that out with how much loyalty you have for her? So I guess with this, both these parent figures, I wanted to do something and add a little bit to migrant literature, how these parents are just stuck together. They're really stuck together. You know, divorce is not an option, right? What is she gonna do? Go back to China, where she doesn't have a life, stay divorced. You know, she's in a country where she probably can't even cheat on her husband because she doesn't know anyone, or, and there's a point in the novel where she says, well, who would even marry me again, right, in this country? So this idea of really being stuck, together, but also stuck in one place. That is what I wanted to portray with this couple. But I also wanted to show that because they're stuck, there's some sort of tenacity that holds them together. They're not, you know, something comes from this being stuck together. A lot of times parents stick together because they just make a really good team, right? They've been through a lot, so they're just gonna stick together. That is also a kind of love. And I think the narrator is trying to wrap her mind around that her parents have stuck together and she can't really seem to stick with Eric or, you know, when he was Ohio, which is not that far away. Another question?
Yeah. So I'm sure you get asked this a lot, but from my reasoning about how all the characters are nameless,
yeah,
is that you wanted to keep their roles very general, but mm-hmm. What always stuck out to me was why Eric was the only character named. Did you have someone very specific you had in mind when you made this character?
No, well, I think I had, so when I was writing this manuscript, I had named Eric, and I actually had named the best friend, but then I sort of changed it. The reason I didn't name the characters was because I wanted to keep it a little bit more general, that you always have this best friend, that you always have this therapist, right? You have your mom and your dad. And the cast was so small that I never necessarily needed to, it wouldn't necessarily get confusing because you wouldn't have two PhD advisors. That would be a little confusing. So because each person has this general name, it's also how she thinks, right? She kind of categorizes people in this general, in this general setting, right? This is my friend, this is whatever. It's a very scientific approach. And I've named Eric because I think he's somewhat of, whether or not he's a good character, you know, I've heard a lot of people say he's not a great character, or he's like not a good boyfriend, or he's a good boyfriend. He adds a little bit of spontaneity into her life, or something that's different, a little bit of color, I think. Or she just doesn't really know where to put it, right? He's in the limbo of being her boyfriend and being her husband, but being her fiance, so she doesn't really have a name for him. So I think she just wants to not define that relationship at all. It's kind of her way of denying it, right? But then naming it at the same time. So that was one of the reasons I had kept him named, because I didn't know how I would call him. She's already in the middle of figuring out the relationship. So naming him was sort of the only way out.
Any other questions?
In your MFA program, were you the only Asian American in the group?
No, there was another one. It was actually a fairly diverse group. But we were like very different writers, so I didn't feel like we were the same. But I do think that there is probably going to be a rise of maybe Asian American writers writing from the experiences that I'm writing from. They have to, otherwise, you know, you don't have this generation, stories from this generation, right? Especially when everybody's going, you know, into finance. So I am seeing a rise in young Asian American writers, and that's actually very thrilling, I think. But because I also think there's not, you know, in our literature, there's not a definite voice. It's not as, I would say, you know, in certain other literatures, there is a resounding voice. Like Juno Diaz is sort of like a voice of Dominican literature, right? In I guess Chinese American literature, there isn't really a defining voice yet, or one kind of story to tell, which I think is actually really nice, that there can be a lot of different kinds of stories. So it's pretty freeing in that way.
So are there any Asian American writers that you do like?
I do like a lot. So one of my professors from BU, her name was Sigrun Yunyaz, and she wrote this book that actually changed my world when I was at that program. It's called Feather on the Breath of God. And it's a memoir novel, and she's half Chinese and she's half German. So she was writing about her background growing up with an Asian father, but a very German mother, and what that was like. Recently, I hosted an event with Jenny Zhang. I don't know if you've heard of her. She's this poet, but she recently came out with a collection of short stories called Sour Hearts, which are very interesting. And it's just, you know, experimental, but also telling the same stories of her childhood and sort of wrapping it in she's a very stylish writer, which is what I like about her. It's like very modern and very stylish. And I guess another story when I was first starting out to write, so you know, in high school, the stories that I read were by Amy Tan. That was the only writer that I knew who was Asian American. And at that time, I wasn't reading broadly, so I didn't have a wide range of experiences with different kinds of stories. But in college, my freshman year, I read this story called Who's Irish? It's by Ms. Shen. I don't know if you've heard of her. She's more of a nonfiction writer, but she wrote this story, and it's published in The New Yorker, Who's Irish? And it's written in the accent of a Chinese woman. So it's written in broken English. And I just found it amazing that something like that could actually be published in The New Yorker, right? Given how, you know, the language of The New Yorker is considered, I don't know, highbrow, right? So it was a story completely written in that sort of stilted, accented English. And it was a very heartwarming story. It was funny. So all of these writers I'm mentioning are funny, and they're kind of contributing, bringing some levity to some of the heavier subjects that they're talking about, so.
Can you maybe comment on how your identity of self has changed? Do you at any point feel less immigrant? Does it vary, or is it more static?
Oh, yeah, of course. One of my views is that you can't be a writer unless you're somewhat self-loathing. That is true. As a writer, there is so many aspects of yourself that you hate, but that you also like, right? When trying to write about, like, okay, so I'm trying to write about an immigrant, how do I feel about this idea of the immigrant or this immigrant person? There are some aspects of that life that I don't like, or some aspects that I do like. There are days where, you know, I think it would just be so easy if I were, if I had just been born here and I just grew up here, and that would have been so easy. But then there are other days where I really appreciate that sort of perspective. So it does go back and forth, I think, on a day-to-day basis. Trying to make sense of the experience, right? With a writer, when writing about an experience, the trouble is trying to figure out how to look at it from different sides. Sometimes you're just so stuck on the inside looking at this experience that it's really hard to take a step back and look at it from another direction. Say that this experience was kind of funny, even though it was really painful, or there was some good that came out of this experience. And so trying to look at it from different sides is difficult. I think there's something that I will always be grappling with, is that as an Asian American, the longer I stay here, the more American I become, and the less Asian I become, really. It is sort of this like morphing process. Some of the fears that this narrator has of her identity is also fears that I have, my friends have, the idea that, you know, once our parents go, we don't really have a tether to our homeland anymore. We're kind of just afloat, right? Sort of like a Hawaiian island, just floating out there by yourself. And that is a real fear that we have, that we'll lose it. Just the language, the history, the heritage, right? So, you know, the reaction to that is trying to learn more, right? Talking with your parents more, reading more, maybe in your first language, trying to just get in touch with that culture a little bit more. And there's a lot of self-loathing because when I was growing up, I hated that. I hated being so close to that culture, right? Going home and like speaking Chinese or eating Chinese food. I hated that. And then when you get older, you regret hating all of that. So it's this reverse process of trying to get back to when you're a child and you wanted to embrace it all. It is very hard. It's very morbid, I think, from day to day. Yeah.
Have any of your old classmates from back in your science days, have they read your book and given you their perspective?
Oh yeah, I think a lot of my friends have. They, you know, most of them, I think most of them like it. They haven't told me otherwise. But I can understand that a lot of my friends are still in grad school, so I don't think they actually want to read it because it's somewhat close in terms of this experience. But a lot of them reach out and ask if I'm okay, and I'm okay. This character's not me. But I think they think that I'm suffering through a mental breakdown. And you know, their feedback is that they're, I get letters from some of my other readers, and I don't know these are not my friends, but they're just readers, and it's heartwarming. They say that it's nice to, you know, see somebody go through the same stuff that they're going through, or to see that this is not all happy and rosy, and it's not sugarcoated, right? It's an experience that's not sugarcoated, but it's also funny, and it's also endearing, but also very, you know, I'm trying to be as truthful as I can about the student trying to navigate her life. The feedback that I get is that, you know, it was, some of my friends found it hard to read because they're still in school, but most of them did appreciate it one way or another. The question I get with friends is, which one of these characters is me? I think that's what happens when you start writing. Everybody thinks that you're writing about them.
So did the World of Chemistry graduate studies, did they take offense?
No,
did
I don't think so.
They think you ruined their good rep or something?
No, I don't think so. I think chemists know that they're kind of miserable at times. They have to know that. You know, this school, there's no setting for this school, but I'm sure it's not hard to guess where I got some of my ideas from, given where I went to school. I sent it to my undergrad advisor there, and he really liked it. I don't think, they know the program is what it is, and I think they actually embrace it, right? So they know that it's very hard, and they, it's sort of like a badge of honor to get through it, right? I don't think there was anything, I illuminated anything to the world. If anything, it was just to show that, just like artists, I think scientists are also, you know, the suffering artist is the cliche, but I think the suffering scientist is more of a cliche as well in this field. Yeah.
Okay, so when I was doing some research on, I saw this article that described your main character as toxic. And I'm still debating with myself whether I think she's toxic, because throughout the whole story, and even in the end, I found her very forgivable, because the way I see her is similar to the way she saw her own mother, mm-hmm. how she's able to still be a little bit loyal to her or forgiving of her because she saw her as a human.
Mm-hmm.
So I was wondering if you intended for her character to be toxic, we'll say.
No, not at all. I think it is easy to think, like from an outsider's point of view, to see her as that way, because she kind of pushes people away. Like when things get too close, she just says, okay, I'm just gonna stop, and then move that aside. And she's very, you know, she's, I would say at times she's a little bit self-destructive, right? She lets things get out of hand. But I wouldn't say she's toxic, and I think that's why I sort of brought in this dog character, just to show that she generally can have a relationship with a living thing, even though it's a dog, and her best friend. I wanted to bring in these relationships to show that she, you know, from an outsider's point of view, she's just this quiet, silent girl who's having a breakdown, and that does sound somewhat toxic and dangerous. But I think in her own internal, because you're in her mind, she's just completely lost, right? So she's not sure how to act, and some of her actions does come out as this. And I think she also tries to be, at least to her credit, tries to be a little bit self-aware, right? This idea that she thinks she is somewhat emotionless, you know, but she's not. She has a lot of different emotions, but she feels like she should be emotionless for some reason, and then so she kind of acts and rebel against that. Encouraged me from writing, so if you do want to be a writer, I'd say it's really strong determination.
Copies of the book Chemistry are available in the co-op, so, and it's being sold back there, so like, just letting you guys know. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh yes, and you'll sign books, so if you have copies right now, please bring them.